Welcome to this session of Hardware Report Engineering. This is the last session of the chapter of TechCV Design. In the previous session, the last topic which we covered was aircraft parking systems. So now let us begin with the new topic in this session. The first topic which we are going to study today is hangar. Now hangar, previously I have told the basic function, that is the terminal area where the repair maintenance work of the aircraft is being carried out. So the primary function or the basic function of hangar is to provide enclosure, that is an enclosed area for servicing and the repair work of the aircraft. What are the requirements of suitable hangar? Now for hangar to work efficiently, which are the various criteria you should satisfy? Convenient door access from site to the apron and the terminal building. So there should be easy accessibility to the hangar from apron and the terminal building. Easy installation of the basic utilities, that is electricity, telephone, water supply or sewer. So all the basic utilities should be easily installed. Reasonable proximity to the loading apron. So it should be as near or as close as possible to the loading apron. Good natural drainage. So all of water should be as early as possible from the hangar site. Sufficient space for future expansion. So, as it is an obvious fact that with the time, the number of aircrafts to be entered will likely increase. So, depending upon that, there should be a scope for the future expansion. Hangar general planning consideration. Which are the general consideration at the time of planning or at the time of designing? Shape of hangar should be such that it covers the minimum land area. Why? Because the minimum land area it will cover, the more amount of portion will be available for other functions or other utilities. And also efficient utilization of space can take place. Shall provide adequate space for storage and comfortable maneuvering of aircraft. So, space should be adequate for the movement of aircraft and also for storage of or any equipment. Number will depend upon peak or volume, as we studied in the reference, that basically the number will depend upon the peak or volume, which are the what are the number of aircrafts which are supposed to be handled during the peak hour. For small aircraft, T-shaped hangar is most desirable and economical design. We will be learning about this T-shaped hangar in the upcoming slide, and also for big aircraft, the nose hangar, that also we are upcoming slide. So for bigger aircrafts, nose hangar is used, and for the small aircrafts, T-shaped hangar is used. Now basically this is the view for the T hangars. Now if we see the aircraft from the top view, it sort of represents shape of a T. So that name is derived from that point. And also in the T hangar, the full aircraft is under the shade of the hangar. So hangar is basically a steel structure. It is sort of a truss structure, and the structure is constructed. The aircraft, that is in the T hangar, the aircraft is completely placed inside that truss structure. So these are the aircrafts which have been placed. For example, 0.3 meter label which has been shown indicates the clearance. That is the minimum gap, minimum clearance which is to be kept from all the sides. Office shop storage is basically that space which has been kept for the handling of equipments or various tools. Clear door opening, that is basically in hangars the shutter door are provided. So this is the door opening for specific this allotment or this area or one space of the hangar. So here there is the door opening, and basically shutter doors are provided. So this is a T hangar specifically for handling small aircrafts, and the full aircraft is sort of parked or at the time of repair maintenance work is carried into the hangar. Next is the nose hangar. So in the nose hangar, basically this is the truss structure which I talked about, the insulated roof to protect from the weather condition, steel truss has been shown. Now here, as I told, the sliding doors are provided. This is the view for sliding door. Corridor is basically the passage for the movement. And no columns at edge of room. So basically at the edge, no columns are kept. Why? Because if a column is placed, then at the time of the parking or unparking into the hangar, it will sort of consume space and sort of restrict the movement of the aircraft as well. So instead, if columns are provided only at the end, then the aircraft movement will be easier and not restricted by the space which is being sort of used by the columns. So columns are kept up to a minimum. The 20 meter is basically the extent up to which the aircraft, which is the, is parked into the shield. Now, this is the body of the aircraft, which is also termed as fuselage. So fuselage basically means the body of the aircraft, and as we can see that nearly half of the portion, a bit more than it, is parked inside the hangar, and the rest of the portion is outside the hangar. So these are the various dimensions. This is the clearance gap which has been kept. 1.2 meter is the height at the end of the truss. 1.8 meter is the difference between the end height and the height at the ground. So ground is the sort of topmost point, and at the end we can see that from the end point its clearance is 1.8 meter. And also 8 meter is the clear height, that is the height from the floor level to the level, that is the bottom level of the steel truss. Now, if we talk about the differences between knee hanger and nose hanger, basically as we can see that nose hanger is suggested or recommended when the size of the aircraft is more, and knee hanger is constructed when the size of the aircraft is small. So, as I told previously that in knee hanger, the aircraft is fully placed inside the hanger, while in the nose hanger, only a certain portion of aircraft is placed inside the hanger. So, first point is regarding what sort of aircraft are we handling. Because if we are handling a large size of aircraft, and if we are providing or if we are fully sort of placing that aircraft inside the hangar, then the area consumed by that hangar will be very large, and that area will be unutilized for any other operation. So that is the main point. Also regarding the availability of space, what amount of space is available to us, that will also make us decide the knee hanger or the nose hanger. Space available is less, then we can choose the nose hanger instead of the knee hanger. Also, as the word, if we talk about the word being used nose, only the front portion of the aircraft is sort of placed inside the hanger. So, the word has been given as nose hanger. Next topic is the fuel storage area. So the storage capacity, first of all, of fuel has to be estimated. That is, what amount of fuel are we supposed to store? So, it will depend upon the type of the aircraft, what sort of aircrafts are likely to visit the airport site, and what are the frequency of operation, what are the number of operation. So basically on the number and on the type of the aircraft, the amount of fuel to be stored will be decided. Aircrafts are fueled at the parking position in stands close to the terminal building, that is at the time of fueling operation. There can be stands can be placed near to the terminal building, and directly the fueling operation can be done near to the terminal building, or at remote places, that is farther away from the terminal building, fuel servicing tanks or hydrants can be placed. So, if we want to carry out the operation at a distance from the terminal building, then the servicing tanks, sort of we can say vehicles, can be used which are specifically carrying the fuel, and by the process of filling, the fuel can be transferred to the aircrafts. Also, pipelines running from the central fuel storage area to the pits can be located at storage tanks. So, there can be also made use of pipelines which can directly carry the fuel towards the pits, also towards the storage area, and from those storage area, the fuel can be transferred to the aircraft. So, basically, whenever the number of aircraft are less, we can directly fuel the aircraft near the terminal building, and when there are very high number of aircrafts, then we can make use of pipelines so that the continuous flow can be there. from the storage area, they can be transferred to the aircrafts. If there is a moderate operation, then we can make use of the tanks or the hydrants, which can move the fuel towards the remote areas or towards a certain distance from the terminal building. So here we can see that these are the various storage structures for the storage of fuel. This fuel, if it has to be transported to a remote place for a certain distance, then fuel can be transferred into these containers, which will carry the fuel towards the aircraft, and then by use of hydrants, it will transfer the fuel from the container to the aircrafts. This is the view regarding it. This is the view for the pipeline facility, in which these huge structures, first of all, are storing the fuel. From the pipes, they are carried towards the pits, towards the storage areas, and again from the storage areas, by use of hydrants, by use of servicing tanks, the fuel can be transferred to the aircraft. So here this is a continuous movement where the number of operations are very high, number of aircrafts are very high, then these pipelines can be made use of. Next topic is the last control, that is the hot exhaust air which are being expelled from the aircraft. The preventive measure to make sure that the hot exhaust does not affect the various fragments in the airport site. So high energy exhaust may cause inconvenience and discomfort to the passengers which are moving at the site. Also, they might cause damage to the equipment and even to the pavement, because pavement can sustain the temperature up to a certain limit. If the temperature of the exhaust gas is very high, then it might cause irreparable damage to the pavement itself. So we have to direct these hot exhaust gas which are being expelled from the aircraft into the atmosphere. Fencing material of concrete or metal is used, which we will see in the upcoming slide. At the runway ends, where full thrust is applied, that is when the hot exhaust gas is expelled from high force, there the fences are of 2.5 to 3 meter height, and on the aprons they are of smaller height. Even if we talk about aprons where the aircraft are going to be parked, then also there the hot exhaust gas will be expelled from the aircraft. We have to handle the gas there as well. So there the aprons, smaller size fences will work, because the thrust is not that much forceful as in case of the runway. There is a difference in the case of the height. Now this is an image for the last fence. Here this is sort of a concrete structure which is placed inclined, and the hot exhaust gas which is being expelled from the aircraft due to this structure are being transferred or being deflected into the atmosphere, and it is making the pavement, the runway, clear of this hot exhaust air. So whenever the force or the thrust is more, that is in case of runway, the concrete fences are used. Next, again, this is a metal fence or a blast deflector. Here, as we can see, it is placed in an inclined manner, and the hot air gas is incident on this deflector, and due to being placed at an angle, the gases are being deflected in the atmosphere. So basically, metal is also used. It can be used in apron, it can be used in runway, depending upon the force. And as the word deflector is used, they will be deflecting the expelled hot exhaust gas into the atmosphere. Now, last point in this chapter is the numericals which are related to finding the turning radius. So let us begin with that. Determine turning radius of taxiway. Speed of aircraft is 93 km per hour and coefficient of friction is 0.13. Now, turning radius we have already studied in the first session of this chapter, and also we know this equation, we have studied this equation in the transportation engineering. Now, turning radius is similar for vehicle, it is similar for aircraft as well. Turning radius is not different for both the cases. Here, there is just difference in the speed and the coefficient of friction. So the turning radius, this is the equation, V square by 125 f. V is the speed in kilometer per hour, which is given as 93, and f, that is coefficient of friction, is given as 0.13. So by substituting the values, we will get the value of turning radius as 532.4 meter. So this is just a simple numerical of 3 marks. Next is to find out the turning radius from Oranjev equation. Now this is the equation of Oranjev, where capital R is radius of taxi wing in meter, capital W is wheel base of aircraft in meter, T is the width of taxi wing pavement in meter, S is distance between midway point of main gear and the edge of taxiway pavement. Now let us understand the terminology. We are aware about the radius of taxiway. Now T, that is the width of taxiway pavement. Now every aircraft has two gears. First is the nose gear, which is a single wheel. Second is the main gear, which is two wheels. So the distance between the nose gear and the main gear is termed as base capital W. And last is S, that is the distance between the edge of taxi wing and the midpoint between main gear. So the path of point midway between main gear, which has been shown here, the distance between this and the edge of taxi wing is capital S. These are the terminologies. Now let us solve the numerical of the Oranjev equation. A taxiway is to be designed for operating an aircraft with below characteristic. Determine the turning radius of the taxiway. Wheel base has been given 17.70 meter. Tread of main loading gear is 6.62 meter. Turning speed is 40 km per hour. Coefficient of friction between tire and pavement surface is 0.13. Now in a few questions, this value might not be given. So you have to assume the value of coefficient of friction as 0.13. Here the new term is the tread of main loading gear. Now as I told that the main gear, which is in the rear part, has two wheels. So 6.62 meter is the distance between those two wheels. So first, here we have to find out the turning radius from three different criteria. Whichever is the maximum value, that turning radius we have to adopt. So first is the simple equation which we have already studied. That is capital R is equal to V squared by 125 F. V, 40 has been given, and F is 0.13, so we will get the value of R as 98.5 meter. Second step is the Oranjev equation, that is R is equal to 0.388 W squared divided by P by 2 minus S. Here W has been given, that is 7.70 meter. T we are assuming as 22.5 meter. If I talk in detail regarding this point, we have studied in runway design classification as per ICAO. In that classification, there were 5 categories of ATPO, that is A2E, on basis of the length of the runway. That is, a range of runway length was given, and also the width of the runway was given. So basically, the width of taxiway is half of the width of the runway. So depending upon the classification of the ATPO, the width of taxiway is decided. So if I talk about category A, then in that category A, the width of the runway is 45 meter and half of it is the width of taxiway, that is 22.5 meter. So basically, that is the topic of the classification of airport as per ICAO. We are assuming the value is 22.5 meter, but this value is derived from the table and the width of taxiway is half of the width of the runway. So in category A, the width is 45 meter. So half of that we have assumed is 22.5 meter. You can assume as per your wish, as per any of the classification from A to E. So this is the value which we have assumed. Now next is the value of S. As we have seen that S is the distance between the midway point of main gear and edge of taxiway pavement. So this distance we have observed, we are to find. Now, whenever the aircraft is moving, whenever it is negotiating the turn, it has to maintain a minimum distance of 6 meter. That is the main gear of the aircraft, which has two wheels. The outer wheel, that is, say for example, if we are talking with reference to this edge, then the wheel which is nearer to this edge, it has to maintain a minimum distance of 6 meter from the edge of this wheel. Repeating again, we have to find out this value, distance between the midway point of main gear and the edge of the pavement. Now I am saying that whenever the aircraft is negotiating the turn on this curvature, the wheel of the main gear has two wheels. So if we talk with reference to this edge, the wheel which is nearer to this edge, it has to maintain a minimum distance of 6 meter from this edge. So that will be the value, that is, if we see the numerical, then this 6 value has been given. That 6 value is the minimum distance which that aircraft is supposed to maintain. Plus, this 6.62/2 is the tread of main loading gear, which I told that it is the distance between the two wheels of the main gear. So in this figure, 6 will be the minimum distance which is supposed to be maintained by the wheel, plus the value of the distance, that is the tread between main gear divided by 2, that is 6.62/2. So we will get this length which we want. Repeating again, 6 meter is the minimum distance which has to be maintained by the wheel which is nearer to this edge of the main gear, and 6.62 is the distance between the wheels of main gear. So 6 plus 6.62/2 will give us this path. So we will get this value of 9.31 meter. In substituting this value, that is 7.70 given, this we have assumed based on ICAO classification. As per category A, you can assume whichever category you want. So that is P by 2, that is 11.25. And this 6, that is the minimum distance plus distance between the wheels, that is tread of main loading gear by 2, that is 3.31, so 9.31, and we will get the value as 62.9 meter. Last is the absolute minimum turning radius for subsonic aircraft, regardless of any speed, is 120 meter. So the meaning of this line is that whatever is the speed of the aircraft, independent of it, the minimum turning radius has to be 120 meter. So as I told that we have to consider the maximum value from the three cases. It is 98.5, 62.9 and 120 meter. So selecting the maximum value from three cases, the turning speed to be provided is 120 meter. So this is a 7 mark numerical in which we have considered three cases, finally found out the maximum value. If instead of subsonic aircraft, supersonic aircraft is given, then we have to make this value as 180 meter. So this is the end of our taxiway design.